Well, pretty good. I got through airport security, so.
We got.
Like I'm having some kind of party here at the airport.
You got some new friends in the TSA.
Yeah.
They did.
They're a little aggressive right now. I think the Bin Laden deal got them all fired up.
I'm sure. All right, you had the original article a few months ago about Ohio State's improprieties and the piece with Charles Robinson, your colleague, about Tressel knowing about what was going on with Ohio State after a two-month investigation, and you guys obviously did good work with that. Looking back, did you think it would have as much impact and fallout as it has had so far, or more or less? How do you see it?
I thought it would be pretty big because it's very rare that you have a head coach commit such a clear-cut violation that really wasn't going to be disputed. And I think that's the biggest issue is normally in these cases you have, you know, some rogue booster or, you know, one kid or an agent or something or maybe an assistant coach. You don't have the head football coach with a paper trail of emails. As it turned out, you know, just there's really no dispute on the facts, and it's such a clear major violation, and a guy knowingly playing a number of ineligible players for an entire season. I mean, these are almost unprecedented deals in college athletics, so I thought it was going to be pretty big.
So, you know, looking back, as you were going through your investigation with Charles and whoever else at Yahoo Sports before the article came out, you were maybe a little bit surprised at what you were finding?
I think the greatest pause that we had was that we couldn't quite you paused because you're like Tressel couldn't have been this reckless.
Mm-hmm.
But so the severity of the accusation and the level of proof was so high that I think that was, you know, that's really what caused you pause. Because he just said, wow, I mean, what the heck was he thinking?
Yeah, or not thinking, I guess.
I mean, he could have got those guys suspended for a few games, two, three games, maybe four, I don't know, and moved on. And I don't think anyone would have blamed Jim Tressel. I mean, he wasn't the one that went and sold the stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody's got complete control over every kid on the program. So it just was, it was reckless, but. You know, it happened. That's the thing. There's no disputing what happened, and that's why it's such a major, major deal. And you know, I don't know. We wondered at the time, is he going to get fired? I didn't think they had strong enough leadership to do it, and I think that's panned out. They don't have strong enough leadership to fire him at Ohio State, but at some point, you know, that tide may turn. I think it'll be interesting to see what happens. I'm kind of fascinated what will happen over the next 6 to 9 months.
Yeah, everybody in Columbus is as well, as we talked to Yahoo Sports columnist Dan Wetzel joining us here on 97.1 The Fan. You wrote an article and a column recently about new NCAA President Mark Emmert, and the heat is sort of on him to get tough. So obviously, President Emmert, nobody in the NCAA can fire Tressel. They don't employ him. Obviously, they can't fire him, but they can do things to make it difficult for Tressel or whoever to do their job. What say you?
I mean, what will they do?
Yeah, what do you think they'll do? Do you think he's going to stand up? Do you think he's going to get tough like you say he should?
Well, Emmert can't get tough in a specific case, and he can't mandate anything in this specific case. What I was really writing about is a number of the procedures, you know, the Committee on Infractions, which is essentially the judge and jury of the NCAA cases, has asked in the past for the ability to put down stronger sanctions on schools that cheat. And the NCAA has not responded to give them that. And I think it's long-term is where Emmert can do stuff. He can't do anything individual. I don't think it would be fair to just sit there and say, okay, now we're going to hammer Ohio State or we're going to make an example out of them. I mean, I think making an example out of Tressel would go a long way for a lot of things, but it just doesn't work that way. It wouldn't be fair. I think what fans want are schools that break the rules to be hit hard, but in a consistent manner. And that's what hasn't happened in college football. I think we can go through a million things and say, well, why did this guy get this and why did this guy get that? And it doesn't make sense. And this school's doing this and it's nothing. And I think that's long-term what Emmert can do. I think, you know, with Tressel's problem is, again, the facts aren't in dispute. They're going to bring him in to the infraction committee. It's not going to be fun. Going to have to try to explain himself, and He has no explanation. I mean, the explanation he provided at the press conference in March was completely ridiculous.
Yeah.
And you know, it wasn't confidential or whatever. He tried a million things, gotten the AD and the president to back him on things I assume they knew weren't true. Yet they backed him anyway. That may work in Columbus. I just don't think it's going to work in a committee on infractions room in Indianapolis.
Yahoo Sports columnist Dan Wetzel here on 97.1 The Fan. Our colleague Chris Spielman came out, I guess, a couple nights ago now and said he's having questions whether Tress will coach the 2011 season. I guess my feeling is if he's at the hearing on August 12th, they're probably going to stick with him. What do you think? Is he going to coach this coming season?
I would think so. I think what will be interesting is you know, the hearing will be in mid-August, and then it's usually 6 weeks to 2 months they render a verdict. And I don't think this one will even take that long because the facts are not in dispute, which would probably, I would hope, you know, cause most of the delay or ponderance on a punishment. But you take six to eight weeks from August 12th, and you're at the end of Tressel's already five-game suspension. And so, you know, there's certainly if the NCAA comes out and drops the bomb on them and you know, really hits them on a show cause and no recruiting and really strongly blames him and weakens his ability and allows Gene Smith and Gordon G to step up. And you know, I think he'd be fired at a lot of schools. I don't think he's fired at Ohio State because they can't do it. But if he's weakened, maybe they can. The issue is he's not coaching. So it's not like they're going to pull him out in the middle of the season. It would be, you know what, we're never going to let him coach again. Now, that's the extreme, and that's the only place I think he's vulnerable. I think he'll coach this year, but it's certainly a long time between now and when he starts coaching that first game at Nebraska. And it's not just now in the start of the season, it's 5 weeks later. And so I think that ruling coming down while he's already out may open the door for it. But that's, you know, we're at like three layers of speculation at that point.
Absolutely. We're talking again to Dan Wetzel, Yahoo Sports columnist, author of Death to the BCS, the definitive case against the Bowl Championship Series. Let me just ask you this before we let you go. You tweeted recently you were up in Indianapolis as part of that NCAA enforcement experience. You wrote, the best thing you learned, 80% of coaches cry during infractions hearings. So what do we think? Is Tress going to be a crier? Is he going to fall into that 80%, or is he going to be part of the 20% who just man up and swallow their emotion?
We were trying to guess, you know, because these women, the law professor from Nebraska, sure, and the from Indiana, I mean, they're tenacious. I mean, these are people you do not want to sit in front of. I mean, no way. That is not my jury. You cannot. They're smart. They're relentless. You can't smooth talk them. You can't, you know, win them over in any way. So they just leave. I guess they leave these coaches and crying. And so we're like, okay, who cried? Calhoun? Jim Calhoun? No way. No way Calhoun cried, right? Bruce Pearl? Absolutely.
Oh,
Bruce,
yeah.
Pearl cried, right?
Yeah.
So we're trying to figure out in recent cases, you know, who cried. And Tress would be interesting. I don't see him as a crying type, but I don't know. But apparently it's an unbelievably emotional thing, and you know, I get it. I mean, it's your life work, and you make, you can't imagine the regret Jim Tressel has right now over that deal.
Sure.
You know, I mean, it's so obvious what he was supposed to do, and he didn't. And, you know, it brands you, it sticks with you, it could cost you a career. It's an unbelievable mistake, and it's, you know, innocent people do not die because of this thing, you know. But it almost takes on the weight of that. And so you could see where guys would get emotional. But I guess I would say Tress will hold out. But I don't know. If it's 80%, I think he might fall into the tearful one.
So we'll call Tress a coin flip as far as the crying. Dan, great stuff. We appreciate it. Thanks so much for your time. We'll talk to you soon.
Anytime. Thanks for having me on.